Morning, brothers and sisters. I am Brother Vinod Samlal from the Monroe Evangelical Bible Church. And this morning I want to talk to you about the principle of sowing and reaping. But before we begin, we have some beautiful songs by our worship team, and then we'll start our sermon. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining me. Thank you for staying here. As I said, we're going to be talking about the principle of sowing and reaping. And with that being said, let's all go to Galatians chapter 6. We're going to be reading from verse 7 to verse 10. And it says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those of the household of faith." Amen. Thank God for his word. I decided to speak about this principle because most of us in Trinidad and Tobago, we have been struggling because of the COVID. It's still going on, but we are now going back to normal. But many of us, because of the length of time that we were home, we were without jobs, financially we may be strapped. Some of us may be struggling with our rent. Some of us may be struggling with our installments with the bank. Some of us may even be struggling with food on our table still because we may be out of a job. So this morning I wanted to share that with you guys. So today I will be sharing four truths that can be derived from this principle if it is applied to our life. Amen. Our first truth we'll be talking about this morning is the more you sow is the more that you reap. Amen. Now we all know that sowing and reaping, it came from long ago, from old farming methods where the farmers would go out there and they would sow seeds and after a while they would reap crops. So here in God's word, Paul is speaking to the Galatians and he's telling them that the more that we sow, the more we will reap. Amen. If we sow scantily, child of God, into God's kingdom, we would reap scantily. If we sow bountifully, we would reap bountifully. Let's look at Luke chapter 6 and verse 38. And Luke says, "Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you." The same measure we give is the measure that God will give back to us, child of God. So if we give into God's kingdom scantily, God will bless us, but he will bless us scantily. Some of us don't even give, but we expect God to give us in return. The principle of sowing and reaping is the principle of giving. We sow a seed and then we reap. But if we sow nothing, we'll receive nothing. If we sow little, we'll receive a little. But if we sow bountifully, God will bless us bountifully. Some of us use God like a credit card. We only want to take and take. We don't want to put back nothing into his kingdom. So we become spiritually bankrupt. But if we invest in the kingdom of God, God will grant us a return. And in whatever we invest, that measure will be returned unto us. 2 Corinthians 9 and verse 6. It says, "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully." Amen. That is God's word this morning. Our first truth that I have derived from this principle of sowing and reaping is that the more that we sow, the more we will reap. But I see some of you out there, you may be saying, "Brother V, I don't have much to sow. I am struggling myself. I have very little home, right? What can I do? Because I have very little." This brings me to my second truth. My second truth this morning is that it's not only about the quantity we sow into the God's kingdom, but it's also the quality that matters to God. It's not only the quantity, but also quality matters to God. We may think that we don't have a little, but little is much when God is in it. Let's all go to 1 Kings. We'll be reading from chapter 17, from verse 8, all the way to verse 16. And this is the story of Elijah and the widow. "Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, 'Elijah, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you.' So he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, 'Please bring me a little water in a cup, that I may drink.' And as she was going to get it, he called her and said, "Please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." So she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, and that we may eat it and die." And Elijah said to her, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a little cake from it first, and bring it to me, and afterward, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth." So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah, and she and he and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord which he spoke to Elijah. It's a powerful message this morning, and it's a powerful story. Many people believe that this story is the story of Elijah. And Elijah was in the land, and the land was going through a drought. And Elijah went to the widow. Many people believe this is how God provided for Elijah. But I want to say this morning that this is the story of the widow and the faithfulness and obedience of that widow. You see, the widow didn't have much. And no one would have gotten angry with her if she refused Elijah. No one. But that day, she planted a seed of quality. And because of that, God blessed her immensely. I believe that the more sacrificial our seed is to God, the more he appreciates it, and the more our harvest will be. We may not have much. Little is much when God isn't. The widow only had a little bit of oil and a little bit of flour. And nobody would have gotten angry if she said, "Elijah, this is what I have. I'm going to take it. It may last me a day or two, and then I'm going to die because there's a drought and there's nothing else to eat." But you know what? She sowed a seed. And because of that, the Bible says that until rain came, she had enough oil and enough flour to eat. And if you read further down, it even said that the son got ill and he died. And Elijah, same man of God that she fed, healed him and brought him back to life. Let's talk about what just occurred in Trinidad and Tobago. COVID-19 just passed through and we are just now getting over. We are blessed as Trinidadians that it has not affected us like the rest of the world. But how many of us are taking this responsibility and this opportunity to sow a seed into somebody's life? Our neighbor, our friends, our colleagues. So many people in Trinidad and Tobago, hundreds of thousands of people without jobs. There were a lot of people that couldn't pay rent. A lot of people that didn't have food on their tables. Did we go out there and reach out to the hungry, to the destitute? Did we make an effort? And even if we had a little bit, even if it was just one can of peas, even if it was a little bit of flour, whatever it was, God would have blessed you. These are the opportunities that God brings into our lives. And he sits in heaven and he looks down and he wants to see what we are going to do. Are we going to sit back, take whatever little that we have, use it for ourselves? Or are we going to bless others? Use it for the furtherance of the gospel, to show God's love to people. What did you do? Let's all turn to Luke 21. We're going to be reading from verse 1 to verse 4. "And he, Jesus, looked up and saw the rich putting their gifts into the treasury. And he saw also a certain poor widow putting in 2 mites. So he said, 'Truly, I say to you that this poor widow has put in more than all. For all these, out of the abundance, have put in offerings for God. But she, out of her poverty, put in all the livelihood that she had.'" God loves when we sow seeds, not necessarily out of our abundance, but out of our poverty. The harder it is, the more of a struggle it is, when we sow that seed, I believe that God watches down on us. And that seed has more power. God loves when our seeds are seeds of sacrifice. Let me give you an example. 2 guys driving home one day. The first one, there was a beggar in the road and he stopped. And when he opened his wallet, he had $100 in it. And he gave that beggar $5 and he drove off. The other guy came, he was right behind and he stopped as well. So when the beggar asked him for some money, when that other guy, he went in his wallet, he only had $10. That guy took out the same $5 and he gave to the beggar. Which one seed do you think that God will bless more? Both of them gave the same amount, but the second guy, his seed was more sacrificial. So because of that, the blessing will be bigger for that one. Now, don't get me wrong. Out of our abundance, it is good to give when we have. But when the seed is more sacrificial, God blesses us more. It is more of a blessing to God. And it is more of a blessing to you. Our third truth this morning about sowing and reaping is that your harvest time may not be the same as your sowing time. Most of us who are farmers out there, we know that when we sow seeds, it takes time before we have to harvest our crops. So it is with God as well. Now, God is good, and there are times we may need an immediate harvest, and in His wisdom, He may provide it for some of us. But most of the times, our harvest takes time to come. Let's go back to Galatians 6 and verse 9. It says, "Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." Understand this morning that God's time may not be our time. But God is always on time. And if we do not lose heart, we will receive our blessing in due season. We must be patient at times in order to receive the promise of the harvest. We must keep on doing good without being discouraged so that the harvest will come at the right time. Now we think when we need stuff that our time is the right time. But God sees the end from the beginning. He knows when we would need it the most, and God's time is perfect. So let us trust God when we sow seeds that we would harvest at the right time. Let's go to Hebrews 6, verse 12 to verse 15. Here we hear God speaking to Abraham, and he said that, "Surely I will bless you and give you many descendants." After Abraham waited patiently, he received his promise. Verse 12, "That ye not be slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, Surely, blessing I will bless thee, and multiplying I will multiply thee. And so, after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise." Sometimes, child of God, we have to endure before we receive our promise. As I said, all you farmers out there, you know that when you sow a seed or you sow seeds, it takes time before you reap your crop. And that is why it is always good to keep sowing. Don't sow one seed. Keep sowing. Keep sowing. Keep sowing. If we keep sowing, child of God, the more we sow, the more we will reap. If we continue sowing, every so often, we will receive a harvest. Don't sow one seed, because then you only have one harvest. If you sow many seeds, you have many harvests. Right? After you patiently endure, you would receive your promise. I'm going to tell you a story about a young man. This young man was going through a very hard time. He was struggling in his business, and things wasn't going that well. But around the same time, his pastor came, and he brought the whole church together, and they said that they now purchased a piece of land, and they were asking people to sow seeds so that they could build a beautiful church. Not only to house us and house other people, but that there are other ministries that could go on in the church. So it was a good gesture by the pastor. And this young man, even though he didn't have much, even though he was struggling, right, he gave. He sowed a seed for 1 year. Every month he would give a seed for 1 year. Now he didn't receive his harvest right away. But after a while, after about a year, 2 years of giving, God started to bless him. His harvest started coming in. Each one of those seeds started to take root and bear fruit. And God started to bless him. So much so that even though he was having a hard time, he started getting contract after contract after contract. And in a very short while, he was able to get out of debt. And he was able to purchase a beautiful property which he now owns. That is the power of a seed. And if we endure, our seed will bring forth a beautiful, beautiful and a bountiful blessing in our lives. So one, the more you sow, the more you reap. Two, not only the quantity, but quality that matters. And three, we must endure and wait for our harvest. Our last truth that I'm going to talk to you about this morning is that whatever we sow, that's what we're going to reap. Whatever we sow. Some of you may be looking perplexed. I want to know, Brother V, what it is that you're talking about? Well, we all know that there are good seeds that we could sow. We could sow our time. We could sow our talents. We could sow our treasures. And that would bring out a good harvest. But there's also bad seed that we could sow. And those bad seeds can bring forth a detrimental and disastrous harvest. Let us read Galatians one more time. We're going to go back. Chapter 6 and verse 7. It said, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life." Amen? For me, there's four different ways we could sow. We could choose not to sow at all. But you know, once you don't sow, there is no harvest. Don't expect to be blessed if you have sown nothing. The second type of sowing is carnal sowing. Right? We could sow carnal seeds. And what is a carnal seed? Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, and you're going to be reading from verse 19 to verse 21. And it says, "Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in times past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." Those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Child of God, if we sow carnal seeds, we'll reap a disastrous harvest. Proverbs 22:8 says, "He who sows wickedness reaps trouble." I believe that even if we are children of God, but we continue to live like that, carnally, as the scripture says, we will not inherit the kingdom of God. Let's go on to our third type of sowing. The third type of seeds that we could sow would be worldly seeds. Now, worldly seeds will be like our careers, our families, our finances. And child of God, all that is good. But that will only take us so far. We cannot take these things with us when we die. All worldly things will have to be left behind. So let us not be narrow-minded and just focusing on worldly things, worldly finances, our careers, our families. And as I said, nothing is wrong with these things. It is good. But this is being narrow-minded. We must look towards spiritual sowing. Amen? Spiritual sowing is sowing good seed. Good seed. "For he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life." We want to reap everlasting life, child of God. So let us sow good seed. Let us sow our time. Let us invest our time into the kingdom of God. Let us invest our talents into the kingdom of God. Let us invest our treasures into the kingdom of God. All of us. God has blessed all of us with seeds. All of us. From the youngest to the oldest. From the richest to the poorest, all of us have seeds inside of us. And God has given us those seeds. And it is a choice if we decide to sow these seeds carnally, if we want to sow these seeds inwardly, or if we want to sow these seeds spiritually. The choice is yours. Psalm 41, 1 and 2 says, "Blessed is he who considers the poor. The Lord will deliver him in time of trouble. The Lord will preserve him and keep him alive, and he shall be blessed upon the earth. And thou will not deliver him unto the will of his enemies." We have to sow good seeds. Did we take the opportunity recently to sow good seeds? Do we sow our time into God's kingdom? Or do we never have time? Is it that our jobs and our families take up all of our time? Bible said in whatever measure we give and we sow, that is the measure that will come after us. Do we sow our talents unto God? Or do we use our talents only for our own benefits? Only for our worldly benefits? Do we use our treasures unto God? Do we take the finances that we have? Do we use the vehicles that we have to pick up people from church and carry them? Do we go out there? Do we pray for people? What do we do? Are we just taking care of our own selves, our carnal minds? Are we taking care of our worldly man? Or are we spiritually minded? Amen. Whatever it is, we all have been given seeds. Yet most of us don't understand and put in practice this principle of sowing and reaping. That is why God's word is so important, child of God. Knowing, understanding, and applying God's word can change our life. But we have to know God's word. Let me use this reference. Think of God's word as a massive treasure chest, a beautiful treasure chest. And inside that treasure chest has all these little boxes. A lot, many, many boxes. But these boxes are locked. And these boxes are God's principles. And how do you unlock God's principles? By applying the principles to your life. When we apply God's word and we apply His principles onto our life, we unlock these principles. And what do we get? What is inside these little boxes? Oh, God's promise. God's promises. So we have God's word, which is the treasure chest. We have these little boxes, which is God's principles. He has so many principles. We're only talking about one this morning. And inside those principles is God's promise. Do you don't want God's promise? Do you want to be blessed by God this morning? Or do you just want to stay where you are? Some of you out there may be struggling. I wanted to bring this forward this morning because I want you to be back onto your path of success. I want you to be blessed by God. And even if you didn't take that opportunity, more opportunities will come. There's always opportunities to sow seeds. The choice is yours what type of seed you want to sow, child of God. Do you want to sow carnal seeds? Do you want to sow worldly seeds? Do some of you don't want to sow no seeds at all? Lazy people don't want to sow nothing? Or do you want to sow spiritual seeds that will bring forth a blessing and a bounty, not only on this earth, but also in the earth to come? Child of God, I want you to invest. But I want you to invest into the kingdom of heaven. That is the best investment that we can make, is investing into the kingdom of heaven. I always say there's a bank in heaven and there's a bank on earth. We could choose to take what we have, what God has blessed us with, and put it into the banks here on earth. And nothing's wrong with that. But we could also choose to invest into the kingdom of heaven and the bank of heaven. And that bank doesn't give you 1% and 2%, but that bank gives you 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. There's nothing and no one can bless you more than God can bless you, child of God. And if we understand the power and the potential of a seed, one little seed has the power and the potential to grow into a forest. Understand that your seed has the power to change your life. So as I close this morning, let's all go over the four truths about sowing and reaping. Let's all say it together. Number one, the more you sow, the more you reap. Number two, it's not only the quantity you sow, but also the quality you sow. Number three, your harvest time will come in God's timing, not your timing. Number four, you will always reap in relation to what you have sown, be it good or bad. So I trust you would apply God's word today into your life, act on it, and prove Him that His word will be true. And remember, God may not be a respecter of persons, but He is a respecter of principles. Stay safe and have a blessed day. God bless.